Hey friends, welcome back to my channel. My name's Connor. I'm a fourth year medical student studying in London, and this video is going to be a bit of a follow-up from my previous video all about how to study effectively. In this video, I'm going to show you how to use Notion to create spaced repetition flashcards. There's going to be a link below in the description for the template on how to use the code that I'm using in Notion. So if you head down there, head to the template, you can import it straight into your Notion dashboard. You might be wondering why on earth you would want to be using spaced repetition as a study method at all, whether it's in Notion or not. We're going to quickly talk about that too. We're going to dive into today's video as soon as you smash that like button. Smashed it. Let's go. Why should you be wanting to use spaced repetition in your studying anyway? What is spaced repetition? How is it useful? Spaced repetition is the practice of leaving a period of time between first viewing a content and then repeating a content. The most basic example of this is probably going to a lecture one day and then waiting a couple days to go over your lecture notes. There have been tons and tons of studies, and I'll link some of them again below in the description if you want to go and do any of your own reading and check out what I'm saying. But there have been tons of studies that have shown that spaced repetition is one of the most effective ways of really increasing those gains you can make from studying content. We know from the last video, linked just here, that we need to repeat content and get our reps in if we're going to try and properly train our brain. But spacing out that repetition is another great way of increasing those gains. Lots of these publications have been studying one of the main things about spaced repetition, and that is, how long should you leave? What is the most optimum amount of time to leave between first viewing something and viewing something again, and then between subsequent revisions? The most compelling evidence that I've seen, and the most compelling evidence found in the literature, is that you need to leave roughly 10 to 20% of the time that you want to remember something between repetitions. What does that mean in practical terms? If you're cramming for an exam next week, then you need to be revising content every 24 to 36 hours. So that's roughly 10 to 20% of that time you want to remember something. If you're at university or college, you've just finished your first semester and you're wanting to remember this content at the end of year exam, so about a year later, then you're going to need to be revisiting content roughly every 6 weeks. If, like me, you're doing medicine, which is a stupidly long course, I have to remember content that I learned 7 years ago in my exam that I have in January. So I need to cover content about once a year to keep it fresh in my mind, to keep it rolling over for that 7 years. So the evidence really suggests that you want to leave longer gaps between studying something for the longer you want to remember it. Now, personally, I follow a slightly different approach, and it's an approach slightly more similar to the inbuilt approach of Anki flashcards. I like to test myself on material at increasingly long intervals. Spaced repetition, or distributed practice, as they sometimes like to call it in different studies, has been shown to have a really high utility. That means it's something that's really easily applied to lots and lots of different courses, lots of different content, and lots of different people. And it's very easy to implement, and it's very easy to bring into your own studying. For the remainder of the video, when I'm talking about spaced repetition, I'm going to be talking about my version of spaced repetition. So that is leaving increasingly long gaps in between revising content. So what does my technique involve? Well, my technique involves testing myself, because remember, learning is an active, not a passive process. So what we need to be doing is actively trying to recall that information, not just passively revisiting it. So I'm actively testing myself on content at these increasingly long intervals. The way that I like to do this is if I learn something, then I test myself on it the following day. If I get it right, I'm able to wait 2 days before I revisit it again. If after 2 days since I last tested myself, I get it right again, I give myself another 4 days. And you can see where this is going. So every time I get it right, I double it. If I've got something right 4 times, then on the 5th time that I revisit that content, 5th time in a row getting it right, then I would not have seen the content for 64 days or just over 2 months. And then if I get it right on the 5th time and I'm waiting for the 6th time to get it right, then I would have not seen that content for another 128 days or 4 months. What happens if I get a question wrong? It's back down to zero. If I get a question wrong, I need to revisit again the same day, and then the next day, and then 2 days, and 4 days, and 8 days, and so on. As I said, this type of repetition is somewhat similar to what they do in Anki. In Anki, you revisit after 10 minutes, and then a day, and then several days. But in my one, I follow a bit more of a strict pattern. I've been using Notion to try and build these flashcards and to test myself on this content just since early December, so I've not got up to anything that is on level 4 or 5 yet. But I've been really loving it so far. Now that you know what spaced repetition is, I'm sure you are really excited to start using it yourself. So what I'm going to ask you to do is to make sure you subscribed, smash that like button, and we're going to jump straight into my Notion dashboard, and I can show you how I set all this up. For those of you who aren't already using Notion, maybe you haven't heard of it before, or you just figured maybe it's not for you, Notion is kind of like an all-in-one productivity app. Many, many people, including me now, have been using it to kind of build a second brain. It allows you to create loads of written and visual content and really cleverly interlink it all so that you can easily find things, things are easily organized, and things just kind of make sense on your dashboard. Lots and lots of creative people who are writing content or creating YouTube videos, that sort of thing, have been using it to organize their own work. I've been trying to build my own workflow in here as well and really been loving that so far. I've actually been using it since January of 2020 when I started writing my blog. I've been writing all of my blog content within Notion. And that all lives in this little tab here. Since January, when I started using it, I've been playing around a bit. I've built myself a dashboard, as you can see, kind of like my second brain. I use it to organize everything. And increasingly, I've been using it to create, organize, and store my different creative projects, my different side hustles. I do all of my tutoring and kind of organization for that through here as well. I have been very basic with what I've done so far. I really haven't ventured very far into the kind of realms of the different coding, the different new novel things you can do inside of Notion, but I decided that I was going to try my hand at a little bit of coding to practice one of the most efficient, as we already know, studying methods, and that's spaced repetition. Here we have my Notion dashboard. As you can see, I have things divided into these little different subdomains. We've got an area for notes and just kind of general task list. And then I also have a place where I'm kind of trying to store all my contacts, make sure I'm staying up to date with people, reminding me when I need to get back into touch with people, that sort of thing. I then also got my personal section here. I follow Ali Abdel a lot, and I really loved his idea of a resonance calendar, so I've been trying to build that a bit. I'm not very good at adding things that I do find interesting to there, but I'm working on it. That's maybe a resolution for 21. I've got my finances sorted out there. I've got a list of books, places I'd like to travel. I then organize all of my content in here too, so anything I'm writing for the blog, any YouTube ideas, any other general ideas, and then social media. My work is also organized in here, so I've got, I'm a self-employed private tutor, so I need to track my income and track expenses, and I do all of that in here too. As you can see, I've got this divided up into this university subdomain, and within there I've got a to-do list for things like deadlines, projects I need to work on. Then I've got the three blocks that I've finished for this. So women's health, which is obstetrics, gynecology, or diseases that have a higher prevalence in women, so breast cancer, that sort of thing. Quality improvement project. Child's health, which is pediatrics. And then I've got my template for the spaced repetition, and the juicy part for today's video, the flashcards. This is where I go every morning to look at the flashcards that I'm due to do that day. And normally, when I do have flashcards due, they would be showing up here and here, broken down into the women's health flashcards, or obstetrics, gynecology, breast cancer, and into the child's health or pediatrics. If you are entirely new to Notion and you're wondering what the hell is this and what's going on here, well, in Notion you're able to build these inline databases, which are databases that kind of sit within a line rather than being a whole page by themselves. And that's what I've got here. Each of these is kind of a call out to another page, which is the main place where I store all of my flashcards. So let's go into my child's health spaced repetition flashcards. And we're going to change the view from the gallery view, which is a very pretty way of viewing all the flashcards, into the more basic table, which shows us all of the items. Now you can see here, I've got the title for each of my flashcards. I've got a level, which I'm going to talk about in a bit. I've got another column here, another property, which is the date I got it wrong. So the last time that I got this incorrect. And then this last one, which is the interesting one, and the one with a bit of code that I'll talk you through, that is the date that I next need to repeat that flashcard. We've got a nice big juicy topic here, which is Perth's disease. This is a severe condition affecting the hip joints of children, typically between the ages of 4 and 8. Now you know. This is how I like to set up my flashcards. So we have a prompt, which is the title or the heading of this card, and that's going to be what shows up on the gallery. A little bit about the disease, and this is all of the information that I would want to be remembering just from that prompt. So I'm fairly lenient on myself. I like to remember several features. I like to remember what the disease is, a little bit about how it's diagnosed, maybe some of the complications, and then the management. These images are here just for my own catch up. If I ever get this wrong and I want to really kind of understand what it is that I'm looking for, and these diagnostic criteria, these diagnostic x-rays really help me with that. I'm quite a visual learner, so I do like a bit of images in there too. What I'm going to do, so that we can see how this looks in the gallery view, is I'm going to change Perth disease to say that I got it wrong on the 14th rather than the 15th. For any of you who are particularly perceptive, you will have seen that the date here where it's due has changed from December the 30th to December the 29th. We're going to go head back to Child's Health and we're going to have a look at this in the nice pretty gallery view. So today's gallery, this shows us any flashcards that are due today or prior to today that I haven't yet done. So if I skip a day, I don't have to worry about trying to work out what I should have done the previous day. Anything that's due today or previously is shown in here. So as you can see, Perth disease, it's got a little prompt here. I know it's a disease of the young, but I thought this kind of helps me remember that in some way. Let's talk through the different properties that I have on this flashcard. First of all, we've got the date created. Now, mostly that's for my own reference so that I can look through and see when I've made these and make sure that I'm making enough over time. Then we have this property called level. Now, the level is a very important thing here, and the level is actually what I change every time I get this flashcard right. Level one is that I've just made the flashcard that day and I haven't got it right yet. So level one means I have not got it correct yet. So when I've just made the flashcard or if I've just got it wrong, I would be on level one. If I get the flashcard correct, then I move up to level two. And again, if I get it correct, I move up to level three. And like I said before, if I ever get it wrong, back down to one. So I'm going to give you an example of me getting it right. If I'd seen this prompt here, Perth disease, okay, ooh, what is that? Okay, that's something to do with avascular necrosis of the hip joint in children. I'm going to level this up to level six. And you can see that I now don't have to look at this card again until the 14th of January. So I've got 16 days to try and forget that information or try and remember that information, and then I'll test myself on it again. If I get it wrong, back down to one, and I'll have to do it on that day, the day after, and then 2 days later. Having a look at another card here, we have information on the poor prognostic factors for acute lymphoblastic leukemia. This is a type of leukemia that's common in young children. You have a particularly poor prognosis if you are aged less than 2, over 10. You have a white blood cell count of more than 20, a diagnosis. If they find you with B or T cell surface markers, if you are not from a Caucasian background, or if you are male. So this next column on my flashcards, this column, it explains when I next have to repeat that flashcard. The way it does that is with a little bit of code that I wrote, and I am going to completely take credit for this. I came up with this. I wrote it myself. It was based off of something that someone else had written. Theirs was incredibly clunky. It was like 25 lines long of code, and I've just kind of condensed that all into a single line of code. In essence, what this does is it takes the date that you last got that code wrong, and it adds onto it a number of days. Now, that number of days is going to be based on the current level of your card. Because we want the time between each repetition to be doubling every time you increase a level, all we need to do is we need to say that the number of days added on are going to be related to 2 to the power of the level. So if you've got it right once, we're going to end up with your level being level 2. 2 minus 1 is 1. 2 to the power of 1 is 2. And 2 minus 1 is 1. So effectively, if you've got it right, if you're on level 2, which means you've got it right once, then you see it the next day. I think the best way of demonstrating this is by showing you a brand new card. So this card has not been really made yet. There's no title, there's nothing else going on. But we have this card on level 1, and the date wrong was today. So the next time I need to do it is today. If we increase this to level 2, then I don't need to look at this until tomorrow. Now, after I've got it right the second time, after I've got it right tomorrow, then that was a 1 day interval. So we've gone from 0 days to 1 day. Now, if we go up to level 3, we don't have to see it for another 2 days. Again, onto level 4, it's then going to be 4 days after that. Level 5 will be 8 days after that. 6, another 16 days. Level 7, we're not going to have to see it for another 32 days or a whole month. First day I've created the card, it's going to be, I want to see that after 0 days. Now, the way I do that is I do 2 to the power of 1 minus 1 is 0. Anything to the power of 0 is 1. And then 1 minus 1 is 0. I then want to see it the next day, which is level 2. 2 to the power of 2 minus 1, that is 2 to the power of 1 or 2. So 2 takeaway one, we're going to add 1 day onto the data that it was wrong. Now, when we get that correct again, we're then onto level three, but we don't want to see that for another 2 days. So where we do this is we do 2 to the power of 3 minus 1, it's 2 squared, or 4. 4 minus 1 is 3, so we're adding 3 on to the day that you last got it wrong. Now, given you last did it on the day, on 1 day after that, that is 2 days more. And so on and so forth. You can see how this is going. You don't need to understand the code, but if you do want to change anything within the code, then there is space to do that. For example, if you've decided that actually this doubling of the days every time doesn't quite work for you and you want to change that slightly, all you would need to do is you need to come into here, make sure you keep the titles of these columns the same, so keeping these properties the same, you could change this number here. If you wanted the time between seeing the content every time to triple, what you would do is you would change this 2 to a 3. If you change this 2 to a 3, for example, you would see it on day 0, then you would see it on day 1, then you would see it on day 4, and then you wouldn't see it for another 9 days. So you'd have 0 days, 1 day, 3 day, 9 days, 27 days. That's a bit long for me. I think I've got an exam the second week of January, and to try and cram lots of this information into my head before then. So a base 3, a bit long for me. Base 1 would mean I see something almost every day. Base 2 works really well for me so far. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoy these little stickers on the back of my laptop, these were courtesy of my amazingly talented fiance, Elisa. So if you go over to the Redbubble link on the bottom of this page, then you'll see where you can buy these stickers. We've got a very cute kangaroo. We've got a nice plant here. We've got this beautiful line drawing. The others are not by Elisa, but they are nice. They're also from Redbubble. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you found this video useful. I hope you go and check out the template below. Make sure you do. Start using this, give it a go, and let me know how you're going. If you find any issues with it, if you're struggling to integrate it into your own Notion dashboard, if you're struggling with the code, if it's not working properly, please drop a comment below. I promise I'll get back to you as soon as possible, and we'll resolve it, and we'll get you practicing some spaced repetition. I've been Connor Dibblin. Please, one last time, subscribe, like, comment, lots of love. See you next time. Bye. Why? Why should you? Oh my God.